sports fans. You're here because you're interested in boxing, or you want to hear what Colleen has to say. This is Colleen Aycock, expert in boxing and lots of other things, biographer extraordinaire. And I just wanted to mention that, not that that's probably a big surprise, I am not the world's biggest boxing fan, but I have been learning a lot over the years. You know, yes, I've seen the Rocky movies and I've seen Raging Bull, and I use a lot of boxing terms in my everyday language. I've gone to Noir City with Eddie Muller, and he's talked about his father and boxing when we've seen our boxing noir films with Robert Ryan. And please make sure and check out his story that he has about his father being a sports writer, our YouTube channel, and also, of course, this month's program, because this is February 2021, and we're here to talk about boxing. And the reason why we've stretched our programming beyond silent films is because silent films were made of boxing matches. And who made them? The one we're really excited about are the Miles brothers, because we have also other programs on the Miles brothers. They did other significant films in the San Francisco Bay Area, also Nevada. So as I was looking over the different fighters that fought that were filmed by the Miles brothers, I saw about Joe Gans. And I didn't know about him. And I looked him up and I saw that a person had written a book about him and a book about Max Baer and a book about Tex Rickard and all these other boxing people. And I thought, I need to talk to this person. Well, that's Colleen right here. And so I'm going to be turning this over to her to talk about basically Joe Gans, who he was, the connection with the Miles brothers and other films of the turn of the last century. So without further ado, Colleen, take it away.
Well, thank you for inviting me to talk about my favorite subject, which is boxing, and this period in particular. My father told me the stories. My father was a professional boxer during the Depression. And so I grew up respecting boxers, the language of boxing, and how bitterly poor many of these boxers were, including my father. So these were all stories that meant a lot to me growing up. So I tried to carry them forward. And certainly when I had the opportunity to go to DC and write for the US Capitol Statuary Hall, during the time that I had left, I would run up to Baltimore and try to do some research on the man Joe Gans and the boxer Joe Gans. There was never a biography before my co-author Mark Scott and I did that biography. And I had always wondered why this man was so great. He was so great in his art and in the science. And he was a black boxer. And in almost everyone until World War II considered him the best fighter out there. All the fighters tipped their hat to Joe Gans. Muhammad Ali, even today, Mike Tyson, when he was going through the Hall of Fame and looking at the pictures, he commented on Joe Gans. And people asked him in that interview, was he as good as Joe Gans? And Mike Tyson, in a very humble way that people might not recognize, said, no. I mean, in essence, no one could hold a candle to Joe Gans. So Mark and I wondered why there was no biography. When I got to Baltimore, I would travel around Baltimore. I was looking for his cemetery, the area where he lived, possibly his boxing gym. And here I am in the monumental city, a city named for all of the monuments of the great founders, even a monument for William Wallace, the great freedom fighter. And here, the native son, Baltimore's native son, did not have a monument. And in fact, very few people, only a handful, possibly, of boxers knew his name. And they really didn't know the story. So why is Gans forgotten? His story was complicated, but he was one of the single most important figures in the period of the 1890s to the 1910s. And in these two decades, we have the explosion, the simultaneous explosion of the popularity of glove boxing, along with the development of film. So Edison is over there in New Jersey in the Black Maria, and his assistants are filming these early boxing, these 6 minute boxing quote matches. They're really 1 minute rounds where they can capture these movements. And so we have to ask ourselves, why is boxing so interrelated with the early and movies and the development of the cinema? So boxing, they were helping each other. The boxers were already celebrities by name recognition. Everybody and most people today remember John L. Sullivan, the last great bare knuckle boxer. But that last fight of the bare knuckle era was 1889. So again, we see that turn to 1890s, and that's when gloved boxing came into being. And a standard Queensbury rules, 3 minute round, 1 minute rest, and rules for a modern scientific boxing. So the scientific development of boxing goes along with the scientific development of these new machines. And so what is interesting is that even with all the popularity of boxing, boxing is essentially illegal. It's an illegal activity. It's an illegal sport. Prize fighting is illegal in most of the United States. At the time of the early fights, New York, that New Jersey, Philadelphia, Baltimore, a little to the extent of DC, but that area, New York, that was the center of all the private clubs, even the public contests. And then when those laws begin to change, we see boxing moving to Chicago, we see it New Orleans, and then we finally see it going out to San Francisco. And then San Francisco, after the turn of the century, then takes over and becomes the big center for boxing when boxing moved west out of New York. So what's happening again on the West Coast? The movies. So again, they work hand in hand. And what is even more amazing is that Joe Gans became the first African American born world champion in boxing, the most popular sport at the time, and the first American-born world champion in any sport. And that happened in the same two decades that we're looking at for the movies, 1891, 1894, he's boxing 1893 professionally, and then 1910. So he dies in 1910, and some other phenomenon takes over with boxing and with the boxing movies. So I find it all so intertwined and so absolutely very interesting. So let me go into the cinema, first of all. Again, why San Francisco? Boxing is illegal everywhere else, but San Francisco came up with the Barbary Coast, and everybody knows all the illicit activity from the Barbary Coast. And then the boxing syndicate that was established with the various venues, Woodward's Pavilion, Mechanics Pavilion, the Coma facility. There were four big operations there in San Francisco, and they were drawing all of the great boxers from the East Coast, the Chicago boxers in particularly, and developing their own in San Francisco, and a pride in their own boxers. So why was boxing such a perfect fit for the early silent films? Because they were a very active entertainment, and they could focus on two objects, two individuals. And that was easy for filming indoors, such as the Edison's Black Maria, or outdoors in the sun of these venues in California. And think about it. We're in the 1890s, we're still at the end of the Victorian era. It's very prim, it's very proper, but there's also a development of a middle class. It finally has discretionary money to spend on entertainment. So these things again go hand in hand with a big audience. Now, why again the boxers? Think about it. The bare knuckle boxers usually fought naked. These are very attractive men. They are physically chiseled like statuary because of their workouts and their strength and their endurance and their wind from their running skills. And they are beautiful, beautiful objects for the cinema. It's also capturing their technical skills, in the new science of boxing, a new science of moves. We're not talking about the bare knuckle brawlers of the John L. Sullivan days. We're talking about the scientific boxers, the Fitzsimmons, Ruby Bob Fitzsimmons, middleweight champion from Australia, Jim Corbett, gentleman James Corbett. There was a reason he was named a gentleman. He wasn't a bruiser. He was a scientific boxer. He was a banker before he became a boxer. Quite unusual for the history of boxing. Boxing didn't start from those kinds of roots. So these people developed a science, including Joe Gans. And Joe Gans was called the old master even before he won the title, because he was an expert in developing the science of boxing. So he developed the angles, the movements of the head, the body weight, how to parry, how to move. And all of those things were techniques that Gans developed and passed down to other generations. So remember the cultural context too, in which these fights and the cinema developed. These are cultural taboos. They make for perfect peep shows. Everybody wants to see a good looking man in a peep show, and they want to see these films. The first boxing films tend to be reenactments. They also tended to follow, because they were on the West Coast, the white champions. But what happens when we near 1900, the white champions are no longer boxing. In fact, they didn't box very many rounds or matches. When you look at the early boxers, they maybe had 60, most had under 30 professional matches, because they could make money with their name and their celebrity on what tour? The theatrical tour. So they would go around and be these stage performers. So there you have the perfect object for the cinema. These people are already well-trained stage performers in the ring stage and on the theater stage. They could entertain an audience. They knew what would entertain an audience. And so the perfect fit, again, for capturing this illicit activity, looking at scantily dressed men performing these beautiful feats of physical culture. This is the beginning of the physical culture movement. But again, the options for filming the white champions are fading. Jim Jeffries, one of these later champions who was filmed, retired in 1905. So he's out of the picture. Who moves into the picture? The lightweights. They're quicker, they're faster on their feet, their moves are phenomenon, and they take over these pictures in the early cinema. So in the early days before 1900, you'll see, certainly on the East Coast in Edison's theaters, you'll see all kinds of early, very short documents in early film. You have two monkeys fighting. You have two cats boxing. You have, by name, two men boxing, and that was illicit enough to look at that. And even more scandalous, you have a man and a woman boxing. No woman would be found boxing. And certainly, what would she wear at a time when teachers of the same age were required two full petticoats? What would a woman wear? But we know Jack London boxed with his wife at the same time. It was an activity to be done in the privacy of your home, but it was an athletic activity. It was a wholesome activity. So you see, boxing is changing from illicit barroom brawl on a river barge into the mainstream of acceptable physical activities as entertainment. So this is a remarkable period. At least it's a period that I dearly love. We even see two women boxing, and that was just most scandalous. But it was the new science. So again, to go back to who were these subjects and who were the boxers, after the boxers, the white boxers left the field, boxers like John L. Sullivan, when they had the title, they drew the color line. They didn't want these great fighters who were Black to take their title. This was still not a socially accepted activity, even in the boxing rings. Now, plenty of white boxers did box the great Black boxers. The great boxers, like the great Peter Jackson from Australia, another fabulously chiseled boxer, very skilled. And certainly the champions drew the color line and never allowed him to fight for a championship. But Jim Corbett did fight him, and in San Francisco, because the two of them were running different athletic clubs. And so it was quite a lucrative match to pair the two of them together. And the reason I say this is because one of the longest fights of all time was the Joe Gans fight, filmed by the Miles brothers in 1906. It went 42 rounds with Battling Nelson. But there was a book produced after all of our research, my research, publications, et cetera, in 2012, called The Longest Fight, another title taken from my work, our work. And there are many misconceptions in there. The longest fight is not the longest fight in history. In fact, Jim Corbett and Black Peter Jackson's fight went 66 rounds. Those were modern fights. They weren't title fights. The fight with Joe Gans was a title fight, and it remains unique because of the cinema. It's the longest title fight, but you've got to add that last part to it, which a lot of writers today don't understand because they don't understand the period. It was the longest title fight ever filmed. So it becomes, in those few years of film development, the epic battle. It was, they said literally, Miles Brothers shot miles of film. In the early days of Edison, it was when he worked up to 50 feet of film or 100 feet of film. But these were literally 3 hours of film that had to be hand cranked. And that's sort of the herky jerky of it and the black and white filming of it, because you have three photographers, videographers, hand cranking at the same time. But I'd like to look at some earlier fights still by the Miles brothers and to show what a period it was. In 1900, and I'm looking at a period, Joe Gans fought almost 200 fights, and he had 100 KOs. And if you look at the black fighters, Sam Langford fought 300 fights. Now, remember, I just told you that the white champions fought 60 at max. There's virtually no modern champion to this day that fights 60 fights. Mayweather, it was a huge monument when he got to 50 fights. And remember, people like Joe Gans, they were fighting longer fights. They were fighting, the championship fight round was 20. When they announced a finish fight, those finish fights that Gans fought were not finish fights in the sense fight till you drop, but they were 45 rounds, limited. So, you know, I just would like any modern boxer to say, okay, let's see if I could get in there for 20 rounds. Well, let's make that 45 rounds and see how we do. These are remarkable physical feats, regardless of your skill in defense or offense. But I'd like to look specifically at the fights that were filmed between 1900 and the end of Gans' reign, 1908. If you look at the first fight filmed of Joe Gans, it was with, first of all, Joe Gans tried for the title in 1900 with Frank Earn. Frank Earn held the lightweight title. And in the 12th round, through an accidental or whatever headbutt, there was a terrible, tragic headbutt in the 12th round, and Gans was cut right over the eyebrow. Pictures to this day show the terrible scarring from immediately in the eyelid area all the way to that bony ridge of the eye. That is all scar tissue for Joe Gans. The headbutt was so brutal that many of the newspapers said that the doctor jumped into the ring to put Gans' eyeball back into, to restore his eye back into his skull. Perfusion of blood, as you can imagine, because only a little scar today will cause a lot of blood and many times cause the battle to be canceled, and in many cases as it should. But in this case, blood was so profuse, Gans was virtually blind in that eye and he couldn't see. He told the referee that that he couldn't go any further. The referee demanded that he keep fighting. That's how tough it was in the ring in those days, when the referee could demand that you could keep fighting. Gans couldn't, and the seriousness of losing an eye if your entire profession is boxing was a potential threat to his loss of income. Gans quit, and at that time also, you were not a quitter. So that proved that Gans was a quitter and that he had the yellow streak, which was a term often labeled at many of the black fighters. Fight language, just the language of it, was so common in the day. People like Frank Baum, you know him from The Wizard of Oz, or his illustrator Denslow out of Chicago, who was the illustrator of the newspaper and in the sports section. Those people knew those terms. They knew what it was to lack heart, to lack the endurance, to fail to go on and to show the yellow streak. Well, guess what language that became in Frank Baum's hands? That's the plot of The Wizard of Oz and the character stories. They're following the yellow brick road. They have a lion who is so afraid of everything. They have a tin man who needs a heart. It's the story of boxing in the language of boxing. So, and by the way, that was started in, I think those books came off the press in September of 1900. So that was all going on, extremely big, popular appeal. Then in 1902, Gans tries to recover and fight back after losing that opportunity. And what we see, so Gans lost the first Earns fight in March. In December, he is approached by Terry McGovern, another great middleweight, lightweight, and his manager, Al Herford, Abraham Lincoln Herford, a Jewish man that was nothing but a gambler and a numbers runner in Baltimore, but he saw a good thing in Joe Gans. He arranged a match in Chicago in 1900 in December, December 13th, not a good Friday the 13th, but he arranges for Joe Gans to throw a fight to Terry McGovern and then tells Gans at the end, you're going to throw this fight because we've got a chance to go get another chance at the title, because Terry McGovern was owed a chance at the title. And so Gans didn't want to do this. Now, can you imagine but throwing a fight. The other thing that was particularly galling, and by the way, when I started working on these books, people still believed a decade ago that that fight was on the level, but they hadn't seen the film of it. And here you have the greatest artist, fast ring general, the best at defense, going into a fight that he has to throw, and it's being filmed. What gall. I don't know if they didn't think that these films would live after them in posterity, but we do have some rounds of that. And if you see Gans, you'll see that Terry McGovern is chasing him down. It's mayhem in the ring. He's slapping and pawing these jabs lobbed at him. This is not Joe Gans, the fighter. If you compare what's going on in that ring for that fight with anything else filmed of Joe Gans, it looks like a comedy. This looks like a Laurel and Hardy event in the ring. This doesn't look like Joe Gans. To me, the cinema proved that this was a fake fight. And what these Black fighters in particular had to do to keep fights and keep fights ahead of them and keep money coming in and the deals they had to do in order to keep fighting. They fought a lot of fights. They fought a lot of fixed fights, and they fought a lot of fights that were draws because they were fixed. Gans was so smart and so talented that he could, in a fair fight, he could call the round that he would send his opponent out so that his friends in the top tier, if they allowed Black spectators in, they were usually in the top tier of the audience, and he would signal to them, and so they would be able to make bets and win money. If you look at the 1906 film, the Miles Brothers film of the Nelson-Gans fight, that film was filmed back far away in the middle of the stands. And so you can see this wonderful epic picture, not just of the fighters up close, but what's happening in the stands. This is an amazing event to attend. If you were anyone, if you were a politician, if you were a noted writer, these were the events to attend. And you'll even see women in attendance. This was just a remarkable social change. So from this fixed fight in Chicago in 1900, Gans was labeled a faker, sometimes spelled F-A-K-I-R and sometimes F-A-K-E-R. But he was labeled as a faker, not to be trusted. And so people were wary about betting on him. And that was the way that they made their money, because this is a big gambling event. People were wary of betting on him because they didn't know if he would throw the fight. He didn't have any choice. These are his manager's decisions. And when those happen, he was told what to do. So in 1903, he's up defending his, he goes back to May 12th, and he has this, because he threw the fight, he was allowed to have a rematch with Frank Earn for the title, for the lightweight title. In 1902, that lightweight title was scheduled for Buffalo, New York. But because the public was so outraged that this Black fighter might be fighting for a title, remember, there was no other American-born African-American fighting for a title. And so it was such, they feared the backlash of this, so it was moved to Canada. Joe Gans knew he had a short time to win that match. And most of the time, the fighters tried to extend the time of a match. This also shows you how good Joe Gans was. He beat the champion in 100 seconds in a KO, with a KO to take the title. If he could win a championship match in 100 seconds, you knew he could stretch that out and win a match at any point in time that he wanted to. So he did win the title. He was lauded for the title. And then he starts having trouble finding fights. Why did he have trouble finding fights? Simply because he was so good. People wanted to take the title away from him so he could get title challenges. But for the most part, if you were a contender or in the top 10 contender status, you didn't want to lose to Joe Gans, because it took away your chances for another opportunity to get at the title. In 1903, he had only six fights. And in 1904, he had 13 fights. But if you look at his number of fights, they were with a large number of black fighters. The black fighters had to fight each other repeatedly. There's a fight in 1903 in Butte, Montana that I particularly like because it shows you through documentation how the black fighters were starting to get their moxie and stand for their rights. In that fight, when Joe Gans, so in his entourage of fighters on the undercard were Barbados Joe Walcott, a tremendous middleweight, welterweight, who was just a brick wall. He was built like a tank. And then also sitting there with him was Jack Johnson, the black heavyweight. We know a lot about Jack Johnson, but here is a 200-pound heavyweight, and he hasn't come to the limelight by 1903, but he's still sitting in the audience. Now, Joe Gans was he was a gentleman. Because he could keep his cool in the ring, he was able to win so many matches. And that's what's really important, to be able to keep your cool in a fight. And that's what people teach kids today. And it's a good lesson for life in general. Just keep your cool, keep your wits, and observe. And that was what Gans' big motto was: wait for the opportunity, and when you see it, take it. And so that's generally what he did in the ring and in life. But here he is in Butte, Montana. He's in the ring fighting Denver's Buddy King, a great fighter. Denver was also a big fight center providing boxers. And some probably drunken yahoo in the audience there at Butte, Montana, remember this is the Wild West, stood up and yelled "Faker" at Gans during this match. This is the first time that I'd ever heard of or ever noticed in the documentation of these fights, in the media, anywhere, where Gans lost his cool. Gans moved over, he was in actively fighting, and he moved over to the edge of the ring along the ropes, and he yelled at the man back, "If you think I'm a faker, come on, come in the ring, and we'll see if I'm a faker." Well, obviously that inspired Barbados Joe Walcott. Walcott stood up and turned to the audience and he said, "And I'll take any fakers, anybody that claims to, you know, that we're fakers," because Joe Walcott was claimed to be a big faker as well, because the black boxers had to fight two orders. Well, nobody was gonna stand up to Joe Walcott, no one. And then Jack Johnson stands up. You know, that's probably the one time I would have loved to have been a fly in the stands to have seen that activity. Joe Gans goes back and he beats Buddy King. But that's the only time I ever saw him flustered. So we know that that label of faker really wore on him because he was a genuinely good guy. He did not want to do that. So in 1904, he goes to Woodward's Pavilion and he fights a fight with Joe Walcott. So that's an early film where San Franciscans, the Bay Area people, gotta look at these two great black fighters, Joe Gans and Joe Walcott. And then all of a sudden, we have on October 31st, 1904, we have the Gans-Britt fight. in Mechanics Pavilion. And at the last minute, and Jimmy Britt, James Edward Britt, was a San Francisco boy. His brother, Willis Britt, was his manager and promoter, and he wanted to make Britt a champion. The San Francisco audience was soundly behind Britt, an up-and-coming white fighter. It was important that he fight Joe Gans so they could measure his merit and also see if he could win. So in 1904, you knew at this point, Gans was not sick yet. Gans was going to win that fight. At the 11th hour, manager Al Herford came to Gans and said, "I made a deal." Gans was brokenhearted. He knew he could make a good showing because he already had in San Francisco. By the way, that Walcott fight was a draw, as most black fights were then, but previously. So Al Herford told Gans that he was to allow Jimmy Britt to, quote, make a good showing. And then Jimmy Britt would foul out. And that was the usual case, because if you fouled out, that was the deal, that was the setup. If you fouled out, the opponent, Gans, won the fight, because he would win by disqualification of the man who fouled. So usually it was a terrible headbutt, intentional headbutt, or a low blow. And most of them were low blows, because those were the fouls that people liked to give these black boxers. Now, it also meant that Jimmy Britt could control the action, because we didn't know, Gans didn't know when Jimmy Britt was going to foul out. He just knew that he had to allow Jimmy Britt to have a good showing. So the end result was they're in a battle. Joe Gans is trying to defend himself from all that he has to do to allow Jimmy Britt to have a good showing offensively. And this went on, and Joe Gans kept thinking, when is he going to foul out? When is he going to foul out? Jimmy Britt, on the other hand, sees this as a wonderful opportunity. He's making a good showing. He thinks he's winning the fight, which he is on a point basis, because Joe Gans is allowing him that good showing. So he continues to fight, and then he accidentally fouls, and the referee calls it a foul, and Jimmy Britt is not happy, because if he hadn't been called out for a foul, he would have, quote, legitimately won the match. So now Jimmy Britt goes and attacks the referee, and the referee rips off his suit coat, because now he's mad, he's a former boxer, he's gonna beat up Jimmy Britt. So it's an out and out brawl. The police come, stop the brawl. But that was the Jimmy Britt fight in San Francisco that turned the tables on Joe Gans and prevented him from getting him any fights after that. W.W. Naughton is the premier sports writer for the San Francisco Examiner. He's at every fight. He knows boxing, and I have a book written by him in those early days. He was a fair and honest. By the way, the sports writers kept the money, the bets and the challenge money. So if you wanted a big fight, you had to challenge with $5,000, and that money would be left with the sports writers. That's how honest they were. But Naughton wrote for a Hearst publication, and Hearst, one in four readers in the entire United States read a Hearst newspaper. And so what that told me when I was looking for why this empty year of 1905, why does Gans have no fights? Why does he have no showing? And why did many people write out that he lost the championship? Well, I had to go back and research this only to find that Naughton was responsible directly, because a full page write-up on how Jimmy Britt, even though he technically lost the fight, I'm sorry, a technical loss doesn't give you a win. But he did say that because it was a better showing of Jimmy Britt than Joe Gans, Jimmy Britt deserved this. He deserved the title. That deserving the title was misinterpreted throughout the United States to say, and then later to be used by the other white champions, that Joe Gans was no longer the lightweight champion. It started when Jimmy Britt was declared the white lightweight champion. But in San Francisco, that lineage went on. The next fight would be with Battling Nelson. Now, Battling Nelson had 60 fights before, reaching notoriety out of Chicago. Battling Nelson was known as a brawler in the old sense, like the bare knuckle days, and he was a fowler. He was known about as bad as Elbows McFadden. And that name, Elbows McFadden, that didn't carry just a wonderful sense of boxing fairness with it either. These were brutal guys. And some scientists measured Jimmy Britt or Battling Nelson's head and said, wow, it's his skull is thick. I've never seen anything like it since a Neanderthal skull. So he had this reputation of being not only a stalwart Dane, a Viking, because he was born in Copenhagen, but just a brutal battler and worthy of taking all the punishment that, and giving and meeting out punishment. So Jimmy Britt and Battling Nelson met in September 1905 for the lightweight champion. But really, it was for the white lightweight championship, because they had black terms, black champions for the black battlers, but they also, now they're starting to say, well, maybe this was the white champion, but then it got just glossed over such that you'll even see in record books today, the fact that Gans' title was lost during that period of time from 1904, the end of 1904 to 1906, when he takes up the fight again with Battling Nelson. Now, to go back and to show how brutalizing Battling Nelson was, you have to remember in that fight, the Britt-Nelson fight was filmed by the Miles brothers. And that fight, by the way, here's another little anecdote, that I was visiting in Montana, a little museum. And I always ask when I'm traveling through and I look at any museums, do you have anything boxing? And they said, well, no, but we have some old gloves. And I took a look at those gloves, and those were the actual gloves used in this fight between Britt and Nelson in 1905. And what that showed to me was that, and I tried to find the cultural backup and how that deposit to that library came about. And these were from wealthy Western ranchers. So, you know, Montana was the end of the cattle line, Miles City was, and in Butte, big fight place. This was cattle land. All, you know, the trails went up to Montana. So these were wealthy, wealthy ranchers. And this shows you that with the advent of the trains and the mobility, people paid big money to go to these big fights. So if a wealthy Montana rancher can go to a fight in San Francisco, they could come from all over the place. And they did in just another 2 years. So also from that fight, Britt and Nelson, you also have big literary people at ringside. You have people like Rex Beach and Jack London and Service. These were all people that had gone to the Klondike for their experience. You know, Call of the Wild, all of the, Rex Beach was famous for his novel, The Spoilers, which took place in Alaska. These people all followed the gold mine, the biggest thing that was happening in America. Now, Jack London is ringside in San Francisco, and he sees all the fights. And I love to read his writing, because in there you'll see the language of these hard-boiled managers. You'll see the language of the good fighters. You'll see the language of the bad, brutal fighters. And battling Nelson through Jack London's hands becomes, and he was, the abysmal brute. The abysmal brute, in fact, was a plot that Jack London bought from Sinclair Lewis. Not that he needed plots, but he thought Sinclair Lewis needed the notoriety. Sinclair Lewis sold him for $7.50, a plot, the dress-suited pugilist. Jack London turned that into the abysmal brute. The abysmal brute is, of course, battling Nelson, who he very slimly disguises as Nat Belson in the story. That story ended up being Jack London's favorite. Of all of his writing, that story ended up being his favorite. And he even wrote Sinclair Lewis and said, you know, I think he only got $1,000 or $2,000 for that story. That was a lot of money then, but Jack London didn't think it was enough. He said, I wonder if this would make for a silent film. And then Jack London said, I don't think so. Well, in 1923, The Abysmal Brute was made into a silent film and starring Reginald Denny. So, you know, everything comes back to the movies. And let me then move on. Battling Nelson then has claimed the lightweight title. And it wasn't until 1906 that Joe Gans had the opportunity to reclaim his own title that he'd never given up. Now, Jimmy Britt said, and his manager said, well, you know, we rightfully have that title because Joe Gans went and tried to win in the welterweight title. He left his title and then tried to go vie in the welterweight division. Well, Gans had to because he needed fights to live on and his gambler needed fights for money. And the other thing that Jimmy Britt said is Joe Gans can't train down to the lightweight limit. There wasn't a firm lightweight limit, but in general, Jimmy Britt and his management declared that it was 133 and that Joe Gans would have trouble. And so then he didn't deserve the lightweight title anymore. Gans never officially lost that title. And he should be declared a linear champion from 1902 to 1908. Let's go back to 1906 and see what happened. 1904-ish, certainly by the first decade of the new century, the Klondikers all came down and followed the next gold streak, the next gold wave, and that was to Nevada. Nevada was an unmapped land area. Goldfield, Nevada was the largest city, and by 1906, it was very large. It had 10 to 15,000 people. The rest of Nevada were early Spanish villages, and most of the mining camps, there were a lot of mining camps, but they were just tent cities. They were large tents, white tents, put up. And if there was anything solid to them, they were board square bases for homes and then tent roofs. They weren't very stable, but these people weren't very stable either, but they could make a lot of money. Tex Rickard had the Northern Saloon. He had many Northern saloons and he always made money on them. He was a saloon owner. He was a gambler himself, but he was an honest man. And in Alaska, where he was there with the Northern Saloon, the gold miners would trust him with his money. People always trusted him with the money. He was a former sheriff out of Henrietta County in Texas. When he was 23, he was made a sheriff. And when he got to Alaska, they always give you monikers of some sort. So he was named Tex in Alaska. But when he got to Nevada, he set up another Northern saloon and he kept the miners' money there in his vault because he could be trusted. And what happened was the San Francisco earthquake of April 18, 1906, a giant earthquake leveled San Francisco. Now, San Francisco was the banking center of the West, and it was where all the Nevada mines cleared their money. It all went to San Francisco. Immediately, the banking connections were shut down. People, miners, saloon owners, merchants, hotel owners, restaurant owners, all they had was the money they had at the time. So Tex Rickard, the only money he had at the time was money in his vault. Now, he was one of the wealthiest in Goldfield at the time. And he had never promoted a boxing match, but he got the other business owners together and he said, we need to promote something big in this town or it's gonna be another boom and bust city. And we need something now. So they all proposed different things, a camel race, a car race, very few people had cars. This was nowhere. This was Goldfield. There wasn't even a train route into Goldfield. So he proposed a boxing match. Now, when Tex Rickard did anything big, he did it very big. Tex Rickard eventually became the father of boxing at Madison Square Garden and established Madison Square Garden, a new Madison Square Garden for boxing. That book, Mark and I have also written that biography, but just such a fascinating guy. There's more on Joe Gans, certainly in that book. But what Tex Rickard did was he sent out a memo to the newspapers, because that's what you did to get fighters. And he knew that many of the boxers were in Utah at this time. And Nelson in particular needed fights. He didn't know anything about Joe Gans at the time, but Joe Gans was penniless because he couldn't get any fights at this time. And so he sent a telegram to Nelson and said, would you take a fight in Goldfield for $5,000? Nelson said, yes, he accepted right away. And then Tex Rickard needed to find an opponent for Nelson. He first thought of Terry McGovern. He sent a telegram to Terry McGovern. His manager threw it away because he never heard of Tex Rickard and never heard of Goldfield and thought it was a sham offer. He got back with Naughton at the Examiner in San Francisco, and he said, I need an opponent. Who's the best opponent? I want the best. The Tex Rickard was always asking for the best. Naughton had felt bad at what eventually happened to Joe Gans. He really did. He apologized to Joe Gans. And he found F where he was, and he told Tex Rickard Joe Gans would be the best opponent. And through Naughton, Tex Rickard got Joe Gans. He didn't even have money for a train fare. He had to borrow it. But when Nelson found out that Tex Rickard was pitting him against Joe Gans, he wouldn't have any of it. He said, you know, I won't even do it for $10,000. So Tex Rickard knew he needed to up the ante. He then upped the ante. Now remember, the big fights of the big champions were usually around $10,000 to $12,000. Tex Rickard ponied up $30,000 in 1906 when there was financial havoc going on in San Francisco. And he put up that $30,000 in $20 gold pieces in the window of Cook's Bank in Goldfield. And he started his big promotion. So he remembered the allure of gold when people in the United States saw pictures of gold in bank windows at the time in Alaska. And he thought the same thing would bring people to Goldfield. Once he knew he had the two biggest names battling Nelson, the brute, the abysmal brute, and Joe Gans, the gentleman, the scientific boxer, the most technical boxer of the age, and he also had an ethnic race. He had the battle against a great white hope, the first one, Nelson, and Joe Gans. What was different about Tex Rickard's fight than the other fights heretofore was the fact that he was a promoter. He knew how to promote a big deal, a big fight. And that's what is different about this fight. He always said that you had to sell it. You had to put it over. Those were his terms. He wasn't a very eloquent man. He was very quiet. Again, very honest, very fair, but very quiet because he knew he really couldn't put a simple sentence together if you want to know the truth, but he knew how to promote. And interestingly enough, when everybody started coming to Goldfield, he built a railroad leg to Goldfield, and these trains started coming in. And there weren't enough hotels or restaurants or even food at that time to support the 10,000 people that were coming into Goldfield. And so they slept on their railroad cars. So there were tons and tons of cars coming in, but they were coming in from the east. And what this was a big promotion for the entire country. So in the past, you might've had a notice of a big fight somewhere and it might get to these various papers, but you didn't have those fights promoted. You had them reported on. So here you have the culmination of the movies, because the Miles brothers were gonna film this fight. It was a 45 round limit fight, and the Miles brothers took enough film to film it. The promotion and the end results, and it was a September Labor Day fight. Remember, only the big fights were on the holidays because the working men couldn't get off. The fights were on Labor Day. They were on New Year's Day. Fourth of July, these were the big holidays. Most of the big fights were on these holidays. So people came in expecting to see a brawl, and they did. And the fight films from the Miles brothers indicates the beating that Gans took, and in fouls and headbutts and other things. Even when Gans knocked Nelson out of the ring, he was such a gentleman at one point, he went over and pulled him up. But what Nelson did was start kicking him in the shins as soon as he got leverage after Gans had helped him back into the ring. People ask George Seiler, the referee from Chicago, later, why did you let these fouls go on so long? And he said, because nobody else had, they had always allowed these fouls, and people came, they came all that way to see a match. And he was gonna make sure that they saw a match. The Miners were clearly aligned with the humble Joe Gans. In fact, Tex Rickard bet on Nelson. He didn't even bet on Gans. In fact, Tex Rickard, when on the next fight that Joe Gans had battling Nelson, Tex Rickard bet on Joe Gans. So he bet $25,000 on him. So he was on the wrong side of both of those bets. Not much from a better, but a great promoter. So at the end of the 42nd round, battling Nelson fouled Gans. If you look at the last of that film, you'll see Gans, his arms were so strong and his punches so powerful. You'll see that he hits Nelson with a punch that literally almost took off his head. I can't even imagine anybody surviving that punch. And Nelson barely did. They said he was on his deathbed after the fight in Goldfield. And Nelson was so mad, he came back, and you'll see that he lodged his hand with a punch so damaging with a low blow that everybody in the audience, the tables had shifted. They were no longer applauding Nelson. They were rooting for Joe Gans because he was such an honest fighter, a clean fighter in the ring. And Seiler had no option but to award the fight to Joe Gans on a foul. Nobody questioned that afterwards. And people looked at the Miles Brothers films and they simply didn't question it when those were shown back in San Francisco. So Gans regained a lost title that he never lost. And he was back in the good limelight of the boxing world, and Miles had an epic film to show for it. That film, what remains of it, it was shipped back east, and the Library of Congress has that film today. So it's a fight worth looking at. But what happened after that? In September of 1907, Gans Jimmy Britt challenged the winner of that Nelson fight in Goldfield and for $25,000. And Tonopah, Mike Riley, the biggest saloon owner in Tonopah, which was 30 miles away, thought he could get that fight for the next year. But it didn't come to pass. It did come to pass with Joe Gans, but it would happen back in San Francisco. The next fight that was filmed by the Miles brothers is the January New Year's Day fight in Tonopah between Joe Gans and a man, Kid Herman Langfield, out of Chicago. It was cold, it was blistering cold. In fact, all these trains were scheduled to come in, a big snowfall came, they had to delay the fight. But the fighters were there in December at their training camps. And this was such a joyous time for the whole town to have these two great fighters. And Herman was feted in Goldfield at the Montezuma members only hotel. Gans was feted at the Black owned Eureka Saloon. And it was owned by a guy named Davis. They called him the Devil Davis, and his wife, Ruth. Ruth was a former prostitute there in Tonopah, and they married, and this was not a, a wonderful relationship, but it was a great venue. Joe Gans celebrated his both his wins at Goldfield and at Tonopah at Davis's Eureka Saloon. He loved it. They had all kinds of entertainment for Joe Gans at that time. The Gans-Herman fight, the people built a giant athletic indoor arena for that fight. Large enough, the largest of its day, to fit 10,000 people inside. If you look at the video, you'll see the glass. The top was all glass, so they could open it up to allow air in for the summertime. They were expecting a big tourist trade, big events for this venue. What you will also see, there are only three extant rounds, the second and the third and the eighth round. And what you'll see at the beginning of the eighth round is just how frigid it was still inside. They couldn't heat the building. And you'll see the winds violently blowing on the ring and violently moving these round cards. And it's so memorable to me that I remember watching these early films with my father, because I remember those round cards, those white cards with the numbers on them. And they were put up so that the videographers could tell which round it was. So Gans was gonna win this fight fair and square, and he was going to end it early. And he did so for the Miles brothers. This eight round fight was the perfect 35 minutes for film. It was, again, 3 minute rounds, 1 minute rest break. But in there, Gans timed the ending of this bout for that eighth round. And what you will see is a remarkably different ring performer than what you'd see, say, in the fixed fight of 1900. Gans, you'll see all of his talent. In training, he went through 9 heavy bags, because when the writer Rex Beach said, he described it as these punches landing like Gatling guns on those heavy bags. They were loud, they were explosive. Gans used his short arm jags just as powerfully as he could just a regular. His left jabs were powerful, not just for measuring out an opponent, but these were powerful blows. He was talented, he could throw combination punches, but he was an expert in measuring the faults of his opponent. And in that very last ring round, you'll see Gans cornering his fighter, moving him into the ropes like a spider lures something in his net. And he goes into that eighth round, the ending there, taking Herman into the corner. Herman fights viciously, sends a left and a right, misses Gans' head by inches. Gans could move his head and miss all punches. His body was more vulnerable because it's harder to move your body. But regardless, Gans noticed that when he moved Herman into a corner, he watched how Herman would escape the corner. And you can see that in the other rounds, previous rounds. And when he watched to see how he escaped, he noticed that Herman's would drop his head down to go in the direction he was escaping. And that's when Gans, in that last eighth round, knew when he was going to drop that head, and he hit him squarely in the jaw. That punch laid Herman out for minutes. In fact, you'll see on the video, the Miles Brothers film, that his seconds rush in and they try to grab him. They hold him upside down to bring the blood to his head. They lay him down. They try to revive him. Gans thought he was dead. Gans could have killed him. He was very relieved when Herman did come to. But that film, that movie circulated for the next 2 years as being the best fight film of all time. It was a perfect fight film, and it was the perfect knockout punch, the best knockout punch ever filmed. So Miles got credit for that, and so did Gans. What ultimately Miles Brothers films did was to enshrine the notoriety and the worthiness of Black fighters like Joe Gans to be in the ring, in the same ring, and to compete on an equal footing with the white fighters. This breaks the color barrier years, decades before we hear of Jackie Robinson or any of the other, the Black football players. Boxing integrated the ring, but boxing couldn't have done it without these great filmographers, such as the Miles Brothers, documenting this epic period in the development of cinema and boxing. So let me put an end note on Gans. In 1907 and 1908, there are three fights, the Gans-Britt fight in 1907, and then two fights, Gans-Nelson. The Miles Brothers filmed the first of the 1908 films with Gans-Nelson, and those were in Colma, on Mission Street in southwestern San Francisco. These fights are disheartening to me because you see Gans, he is weathered, he's accepted the challenges because he needs the money. With the winnings from his Goldfield fight, he established the Goldfield Hotel back in Baltimore, and it was a black and tan club, a mixed race club, and it was the port of call, and it was the beginning of the jazz age, and he hired UB Blake. He gave UB Blake his first job. UB Blake played 12-hour shifts in Gans Hotel. When Jack Johnson went through, he always stopped there, and he loved the hotel. And it was from Joe Gans' enterprise that Jack Johnson got the idea for the Cotton Club, and then certainly for his Club Deluxe back in Chicago. But Joe Gans, you know, was at the heart of every pioneering movement of cinema, the jazz age, and certainly the advent of professional scientific boxing. When you look at those last films of him, he was consumed by tuberculosis. It was believed that the fights in 1906 and certainly the cold air in 1907 wrecked his body. His first wife had already died from TB. Baltimore was one of the epicenters of tuberculosis, and Gans had it. And Herman Miller, his sparring partner, died of it. So Gans saw what was likely to happen to him. In the Gans-Nelson fight of 1908, he goes down for a final time in the 17th round. He's already gone down five times, three times to take a nine count. And the next one is an eight count and finally to be counted out. And it's pitiful watching that. He's skin and bones, absolutely skin and bones. He had no trouble making the weight. By September 9th, he takes another one. He hopes to reclaim the title. It's a 21 round bout. And Gans again lost to Battling Nelson. Battling Nelson went to his grave saying that he did not foul Gans out in 1906. But in 1909, they met again on the stage in Baltimore, Gans and Nelson. Everybody was crying. There were tears in both of their eyes. And they really met as two just great gladiators. Gans makes his last trip in 1910 back west. He goes in the summer to recuperate from TB and these ghastly, ghastly treatments that he's been given. But he lands in Phoenix, and anybody that's been in Phoenix in the midsummer knows it's way too hot to stay there and recuperate from any disease. So he goes up to Prescott and he tries to recuperate there. And Prescott was the territorial capital of Arizona. It was Hyled and a mile high city and dry. And it was known for its tubercular clinic. Now, Gans is a black man, and but he was a wealthy, well thought of prize fighter and sportsman. So he was welcomed into Prescott. Interestingly enough, I was moved from Texas to Prescott, Arizona when I had severe asthma as a teenager. And I graduated from Prescott High School and spent the last 2 years of my life in the 60s recuperating in an apartment with my mother, only blocks away from where Joe Gans recuperated. So my heart is still there with Gans and knowing what he went through. Finally, he was there also to be the great second for the Great White Hope fight with Jim Jeffries and Jack Johnson. That would happen again in Nevada in 1910. Now, Jack Johnson didn't take well to any trainers, but he loved Joe Gans and he really wanted Joe Gans as his main second in the ring with him for that fight. Unfortunately, Joe Gans can't live. And one of my friend's grandfather took Joe Gans as a doctor on the train, and that train he took him back to Baltimore because Joe Gans wanted to die in the arms of his mother. You couldn't take a dying body on a train at the time. No one wanted a body on the train. So this doctor went with him to give him all the help he could, certainly oxygen. When he got to Chicago, the change in Chicago to Baltimore, he was taken off the train and he was nothing but just nothing, skin and bones. And they told him, you can't go any further. But Gans had weathered 42 round fights. Gans had the endurance and he said he would make it to Baltimore. He was there for less than a week and died with his mother next to him, his fighting friends next to him. And it just was a sad ending to an absolutely beautiful life. A year earlier, back in Prescott, John L. Sullivan and Jake Kilrain came for a last meeting as a draw, a publicity draw, there in Prescott, Arizona. And the big event was to show the Gans-Herman fight. And that, again, just says everything, that the fight, those two great gladiators were around and got to see again was that fight with Joe Gans. So I hope that this little expose on Gans' life and how he related to the cinema and how the two developed with him, because you know what happened after Gans' death in 1910. The fight, the Great White Hope fight, was filmed. But after that, Jack Johnson, through his personality and through his annex and through many other things, so offended the white race that there were the interstate travel for fight films came to an end. That came to an end with Jack Johnson. So it severely affected the money-making ability for these fight films. And then you see the direction of the movies taking on now the more fictional roles for the fights, and I think the great movie metaphors for all time, which were the boxing films to come. Gans changed our culture, and the movies have changed our culture, and boxing has been an important theme for the movies throughout the history of the movies. So thank you for letting me share that.
Thanks very much. Oh my goodness. There's so much to unpack from all of that. I want to thank you very much, and everybody should be looking forward to the Q&A coming up on Saturday, February 20th. And that, let me make sure I have that date right. Yes, the 20th, and that'll be at 5 p.m. Pacific time. 20th, yes, the 20th. 5 p.m. Pacific time. Otherwise, we will see you at that time. Thank you, Colleen. Really appreciate it.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Really enjoyed it. Thank you for letting me leave that bit of history. Because that's not a subject that I've spoken on. I've talked a lot at during Black History Month and a lot of podcasts, but not the relationship with the cinema. And I think that is just really important. They go hand in hand. And if it weren't, and I truly believe if it weren't for the cinema, we wouldn't have this absolutely factual record for Joe Gans.
Well, I got hung up on the Britt Nelson fight because of the connection of how that fight was shorter and that left film stock. And that's why a trip down Mount Tamalpais and a trip down Market Street even got filmed. And then looking more at their fights and seeing Joe Gans' name and learning more about him, it came full circle, literally, and you helped with that. So thanks so much.
They always say there's a 6-degree separation in boxing. Somewhere you can find the relationship, and I hope the relationship to Reginald Denny. And, you know, it all goes back, circles back through the writers. And, you know, I started, this is just an ad hoc statement, but, you know, I started my academic career as a rhetorician, you know, in rhetoric, linguistics, and literature. And so my kids always joke that in the beginning for mom was the word, and shortly thereafter, there was a boxing match. And I'm sure it had something to do with that area of the Garden of Eden, but it's still going on today. So, you know, yeah, everything's connected. And it's connected through boxing, I think.
Wow. All right, we'll bring this to a close. Thanks so much.
Thank you.